had to go to California for emergency meeting, so I have to replace him to give a different lecture. And so this topic is more related to my own research. It's so on your previous lectures, you have been talking about a lot of basic neuroscience and computational models. And I think this lecture is more based on the technical part or practical part, how people get those data from the brain. So by the way, for those who never met my face before, I suppose you should already all know me by now. I'm Yueqi Guo, and my advisor is Dr. Wang, and our lab studied the auditory cortex on marmoset monkeys. So my project is based on developing a called two-photon microscope to image the auditory cortex activity. So my whole lecture will be about this type of optical methods used in neuroscience. Okay, so before I start, I would like to step back a little bit to think about the question, what are the neuroscientists doing? So basically, if you look at the brain with an engineer's point of view, it's like the reverse engineer of the brain, right? So ultimate goal is to figure out what is in this black box. So you have the input, which are the stimulus, and the output are the behavior or sensation. And for neuroscience, basically, you want to figure out how does each component in your brain work, and how does the brain process the stimulus, then generate the outputs. Okay, so reverse engineering. According to Wikipedia, it's just the process of extracting knowledge or design information from anything man-made, in this case it's not man-made, and to reproduce it or reproduce anything based on this information. So in a sense, it's like artificial intelligence is just to, they want to extract the information from the real intelligence, then apply to some other field to build, like reproduce something else or something even more powerful. Okay, so then what methods can you use to do this type of reverse engineering for the brain? So we have been talking about, so one method is to measure the input-output function in like as many as possible this intermediate stage of this black box. So in your previous lectures, the professor really mentioned that we record from somewhere in the brain. And by recording, they usually mean just poking an electrode into the brain, an animal's brain, then measure the neural activity, at the same time present some stimulus and see what are those components responding. So that's like insert an electrode into this black box and trying to figure out what is each component, like how does each component work. So another method is to, you could generate some perturbation to this network, then see what has changed. For example, like for those patients with some mental disorder, there might be some place in this box is broken, then there are some change on the behavior or sensation part. Then now as engineering, we can also do some type of stimulation to artificially stimulate some of this black box, then see what is changed in terms of behavior. So that's a second method. Okay, so if you think about this stimulation part, what people usually do is, for example, you can use the TMS, which Dr. Shamir has mentioned before. So you place a coil on the skull, and it delivers a magnetic field. Then the magnetic field can stimulate a part of your brain. Then see what does the person behave, like how does it change. So that's one type of stimulation. And you can also use some other methods, like electrode stimulation or optical stimulation. So I'll introduce later. Okay. So now I just want to focus on the first part first, and how do you probe this system? Like how do you get information from this system? So the traditional way is because the brain is giving out electronic signals, which are current and membrane potential change. So the intuitive way to record from the brain is to use some electrode or magnetic, like fMRI or just electrode recording. But the thing is, with this electrode recording, you can see what is inside. Like, you know there are some neurons lying there, and you can see the response from that neuron, but you can see the neuron itself. So, like, the question is, why do we want to see it? So why do we want to do imaging? Do you have any answers? Why don't you just look at the trace from the electrode recording? Yeah?
It's more non-invasive.
Yeah, but I'm talking about animal experiments. So for animal, you can basically do anything you want. not like, although electrode has some damage, but that's a little bit trivial problem. Yeah, just think about human, because Dr. Connor said, vision is your superpower, right? Because humans are visual animals. We got all the information, like, in terms of auditory vision and somatosensory, the visual information is the most straightforward, or our visual system can extract a lot of information from a visual picture. So it's better if we can see those neurons. And another reason is I like to make this comparison. So if you drop an electrode in the brain, it's like fishing. But if you dive into the cortex, you can actually see those fish. That's a different situation, right? So in the first case, the traditional electrode recording is, okay, like blind search, then you can't really locate where is that fish from. You can roughly say, because I dropped my electrode here, it could be somewhere around here. But for optical imaging, you can locate each individual neuron with much higher spatial resolution. So by the way, by optical imaging, we are talking about imaging with cellular resolution and in vivo, which means the brain is still inside the animal skull and alive. So then the next advantage of optical imaging is if you consider what you can see from one electrode, it's a spike or membrane potential waveform. So it's like you can only observe one individual response at one time. But for optical imaging, you can respond a lot of neurons at the same time. So there are some more questions you can study, like does the population respond to a stimulus? Or what is the connection between each individual neurons? So with optical method, you can explore much more broader question in neuroscience. Although there are some people using like multiple electrodes, trying to observe multiple individual neurons at the same time, but compared to optical imaging, the resolution is still much lower. So that's the introduction of why am I talking about this. I guess in the beginning, I separate my lecture into two parts. One is the optical imaging, and the other is optogenetics. But I guess I'll focus on mainly the first part, because it's a lot of information already. Okay, so before we move on, let's review some of basic questions. What is light? Answers? Definition of light? Guess maybe answers. Yeah.
Is it an electromagnetic wave?
Yeah, that's one definition. And I mean, people may have different views because light is actually a weirdly behavior particles, which has a behavior similar to waveform. So it's like it's called wave particle duality. So depending on what are you analyzing, you can consider light as different stuff. So like in the first case, light is just straight lines. And in the second case, it becomes waves. And in the third case, this is the particle, which is one photon. And each photon has an energy related. So depending on what are you analyzing, you can consider light as line and electromagnetic wave or particle. So first, let's consider light as just straight lines first. These are maybe some review from your basic physics lecture. If you have a lens here, then you have a light source. And so this point from this point to this lens, this distance is the focal length of that lens. Then what can you see from the other side? The light. OK, I'll just tell you the answer. So that's the parallel beam, right? OK, then the next rule, what if you have a parallel beam coming in? Then the lens focus on the focal point right here. Right? So if you compare this one and this one, it's just reverse. OK, then what if you have a parallel beam, but not like horizontal parallel beam? What if you have a parallel beam with an angle? Then what you can see on this side is it's still focused, but on a different point. But this different point is at the same focal plane. So this plane, from this plane to this lens, this distance is still the focal length. So what does a lens do is to just change the direction of this parallel beam to position at that focal plane, right? So the lens is just transferring an instant parallel beam angle to a position of a point on the focal plane. Okay, so that's some basic understandings about optics. Okay, then now let's consider how does an image form. So let's start from this point. So imagine there's an object here. Then from this point, this object is emitting light, light of all different directions, right? Now I'm just looking at these three beams, these three different directions. So this parallel beam come down, passing through this focal point, then go straight. Then this one just go through this center and then go straight. And this third beam just go to here, then parallel. Then all these three beams converge at some point here. So this is actually an image plane. So if you put something, put a screen on this plane, you can see an inversed image of your object, right? So if you consider when is an image is formed, it's actually, by definition, it's if you have one point on the object, no matter which direction the light is, you can still see one point at that image plane. So that is defined as the like image plane. Right? So each lens should have a corresponding, if you have an object here, then it should have a corresponding image plane on the other side. Okay, now if you continue follow these slides, then after this point it becomes diverged, then you have another lens, then after this it becomes a parallel, and then enter your eye. So this is the third lens here, right? Then after this it becomes a converged point on the retina. So this is this lens on your eye is converting the direction of this parallel beam to a point, position of point on your retina. Okay, so that's actually basically how does a basic microscope work. So you have something there, then passing through two lenses, then fall onto your eyes. Okay, question? Okay. Now, if you look at, so by now we are all considering light as straight lines. Now if you look at this point, is that a small point or is that a infinitesimally small point? It shouldn't be, right? Otherwise you should see anything like without any limit. So in this case you have to consider light as wave. So each this vertical line is the position of the peaks of each wave. So now you can call this as wavefront. So this like these are orthogonal to this light beams. Now, if you consider light as waveform, then this point is also called focal point, and this is not a very, very small point. It has a size which is related to the characteristic of this light wave. Okay, you may remember, so now we are considering light as waves. Now you may remember the physics class that if you have two waves, there will be some interference, then you see this dark and light pattern on this plane. And this is called interference, and this is called diffraction. So if you pass some small hole here, then this is the pattern you can see on the other end. Okay, now if you consider microscope, so this is the objective, then this is actually you're sending or collecting light from here, then this pattern is very similar to this diffraction pattern. So in this case, the resolution of a microscope is limited by this diffraction phenomenon. So you have to consider light as waveforms here. So now let's take a closer look at what is that point looks like. So if you have a parallel beam sending from this objective of the microscope, then you see at this focal point, you actually see some complex pattern like this. And this is z-axis, and this is x-axis. And if you take a cross-section around here, then you can see a xy dimension, this like a ring structure with a very dense light intensity in the middle. So you can see that this point has some size, which is in this case 400 nanometers. And along this z direction, it's even longer, which is 1.7 microns. So even though you have light sending from the microscope, it doesn't focus on absolutely like one single point. It's a very small region. And this is determining what is the best resolution you can get from the microscope. So if you have an object like this, and this is called point spread function. Oh, I should have written here. So this function is characterized by point spread function, which is a 3D function. So it has x, the z and xy axis. So if you have an object and point spread function, which is a 3D structure, then the final image you get should be a convolution of these two. So if you compare the image with this real object, it becomes blurred because of this point spread function and because of the diffraction phenomenon, right? Okay, question? Okay, now if you look at your image from a microscope, now imagine you have multiple dots or multiple molecules in your sample which are giving out light, then this is the image fall onto your detector. So each one is a convolution of this point spread function, then the final image is not single dots, it's overlapping point spread functions. Okay, so for example, if these two dots are too close to each other, then you cannot resolve whether that's one or two dot, this one. One or two dot, then this is not resolved. So it's limited, your image is limited by your resolution. So a similar idea is the receptive field you have talked about before. So if the receptive field is also like a curved Gaussian function, right? If you have two stimulus happen at the same time, it has to be farther away from the width of your receptive field to be resolved. Okay, so now this resolution or this size of this PSF could actually be quantified. So if you have a light coming from the objective, then focus here, then this is the z-axis. This should be a z-axis PSF. So it looks like this. And this is the xy plane, and this is a PSF on xy plane, which could be characterized by this called array disk, which is the size of this middle circle. Okay, now you can define a resolution limit called Abbe resolution limit, which is when you have something apart with a fraction of this width of this PSF, then you can decide that these two objects are not resolvable. So this Rxy means the minimum distance you can tell in xy plane, and it is written as lambda over 2na. So lambda is just the wavelength of the light, and na is called numerical aperture. So let's look at what is numerical aperture. So this is an objective on your microscope. Then numerical aperture is defined as, where did I write it? Okay, you can see on that figure it's n times sine mu. So mu is the angle from the center line to the maximal collection angle you can achieve. So this is angle mu, and n is the refractory index between your sample and the objective. So some microscope has to work in the air, or immersed in water, or immersed in oil. So depending on what media you are using, this n could be large or small. So for air, n equals 1, and for water, n equals 1.3, and for oil, n equals 1.5, something like that. So you can see from the previous equation, if you want this value to be small, you want a large Na, right? That means you have a higher resolution. So how do you get large Na? You can do it by two methods. One is to enlarge the size of the objective. One is to just move closer to your sample, right? So why don't you just move closer to your sample for every objective? That is because every objective is designed for a specific working distance. So you have to keep your sample at some distance away from your objective. So if you look into the objective itself, it's very complicated. It has a lot of lenses inside the objective. So you can't just arbitrarily change the distance between your sample and objective. So each objective is designed with a specific Na. Then in order to get higher resolution, you have to buy an objective with a larger Na, which means you have to spend more money. Okay, so large Na means large angle, and okay. So large angle is either by achieved by shorter working distance or bigger radius. Okay, now if you look back to this equation, then the other parameter is lambda, right? Then you can imagine the shorter lambda, the higher resolution you have. So shorter lambda means more blue and purple, and longer wavelength means more red and yellow. Okay, then what else does resolution depend on? So if you think about what are you collecting, so normally you can use your eyes to see the image, or you can mount a camera on the microscope to capture those images. So in this case, the resolution is also dependent on the camera's resolution. So even if you have a PSF like this size, and the camera has to be able to resolve this PSF. So each pixel should be much smaller than that. Okay, so that's just some basic ideas of how does a microscope work. And I guess probably all of you have seen this in the lab. Now, how does this work is just to illuminate something. You place a sample on this platform, then illuminate that thing, then magnify this with two lenses. Then see it. It's very simple, right? Now, can you put a brain on here? Then can you see it? So there are... No, right? Actually, yes. I'll show you later. Not, I don't mean like brain slice, the whole brain. Like, you, can you put a mouse there and open a window on the skull then just see the neurons? No, yeah. Okay, so there is something else we need to do because the neurons doesn't give out light, right? So you have to figure out how to illuminate the neurons. So for brain slice, it's very easy. You can just illuminate from the light below. But for brain, you can insert a light source into the brain. So another way to do it is to shine light on the surface, then collect the reflected light. And there's some even better way, which is fluorescence. So you have seen this in daily life because the fluorescence marker, when you're marking something, that contains some fluorescence molecules. So there are some other animals that has this kind of fluorescence proteins or some fluorescence molecules. So this is the most famous one. This is called GFP, which is green fluorescence protein. So these are discovered in jellyfish, and this is the structure of this GFP, the superstar in optical imaging. Okay, so this is some physics about what is fluorescence. So for each fluorescence molecule, these are some quantum physics I'm not very familiar with, but the key point is there are some stable state and there are some excited state, which are these lines, and these are discrete. So for a molecule, it can absorb a certain a photon with a certain wavelength, then jump to this excited state. So then what happens afterwards is this molecule will relax, then go back to this stable state, and at the same time emit some other wavelengths. Okay, so the process is you absorb some photon, then emit some other photon. And the difference between these two is one is a higher energy, which is shorter wavelength, right? So this is blue in this case. And when you're emitting this energy, you're jumping from here to here. So that's a lower energy, which has a longer wavelength. So this just showing you where does the green of GFP come from. So usually you can shine some blue light on that molecule, then you can see some green light come out. Okay, so now we have some fluorescence we can use, and we also have the microscope. Can we just inject some fluorescence molecules into the brain, then use the microscope to see? Maybe you can do that, right? Now, I'll start with some imaging techniques. So first, how do you label those neurons? And second, how do you use microscope to see those neurons? So in terms of labeling, the easiest way you can think of is maybe just inject some fluorescence molecules or some other fluorescence dyes, then all the neurons will be giving out light. Then you can just use the microscope to see those neurons. Okay, so that could be working, but another better way is to use some virus transfection or transgenic. So a huge advantage of this technique is because each of these fluorescence molecules is pressed in it's transfected by those virus. So like shown in this red dot, in this case it's called our AAV, which is adeno-associated virus, which doesn't cause any disease, but you can use them to transfer your DNA, which encode this fluorescence protein into these neurons. Then these neurons will be fluorescent. Okay, and another advantage is you can modify your viral vector, which is the DNA RNA sequence, and selectively make them expressed in a subset of cell types. So for example, if I'm only interested in see the inhibitor neurons or excitatory neurons or even some glial cells, we can modify this viral vector to make this fluorescence protein only expressed in a subset of neurons. So compared to the previous method, if you inject a bunch of fluorescence dye, then all the neurons, no matter what type it is, it could be all becomes fluorescent. Right? So this provides a more flexibility on how do you want to study your problem. Okay, so this is example showing you each neuron could be programmed, or you can program your DNA to make it express random color combinations for each neuron. Then you can see different neuron has a different color, and this is called Brimble, which was very popular 5-10 years ago. So then previously we have been talking about labeling the whole cell, right? So you can see the structure of a cell. Now what if you want to see the cell when it's active? So you only want to see the neuron, like the fluorescence increase when the neuron is active, then you need to convert some of the electronic signal to light, right? So this is the most commonly used technique, which is called genetically encoded calcium indicators. So this stuff is just a, okay. So this is a combination of a calcium sensor and a fluorescence protein. So why do we use calcium? Because if you think about the dynamics of a neuron, if you have an action potential here, then you got depolarization, then there are a lot of calcium channels on the membrane. So there will be a calcium influx to the cell, right? So there will be a huge increase of calcium concentration inside of this cell. Then now this calcium sensor can combine those calcium, then activate this fluorescence protein. Then now if you excite those fluorescence, you can see the green light come out. Okay. So this is a diagram showing you how does that work. So there are three components. This blue part is the CAM called calmodulin, which combines the calcium. And this part is the GFP part. So when there's no calcium inside, this GFP doesn't work. So if you shine light on those GFP, it doesn't give you green light. But once you have calcium come in, and you can see there's some structure change on this molecule, then this GFP component becomes activated. So if you have blue light come in, then it will give you green light. Okay. So this is a strategy, how do you convert those calcium signal to the light signal so that you can see when the neuron is active. Okay, so this is the structure of this called G-camp. And there are several different types of G-camp. And currently this the black curve is called G-camp 6S. This can generate the strongest signal. So if you look at this y-axis, which is the fluorescence change when the cell is active over the baseline fluorescence, then this change is about 30% when you have only one action potential. So now if you have 10 action potential, this fluorescence change could be about 5 times bigger. So this could give you very bright light and very sensitive to neuron response. Okay. Now we have tools to make the neuron give light, and also we have tools to image the functional data. So can we use this microscope to image now? Maybe yes. The only thing you need to do is to open a window on the skull. If you open a window and those fluorescence proteins are already inside the brain, then maybe you can see something. So here's is the most simple setup. So you have some light coming here, then reflect back to this sample. In this case, it's a brain or a mouse lying here. Then those fluorescence proteins will be activated. Then this green light will come back. Then this called dichroic mirror. So this mirror just every green light will pass through this mirror, and this purple or blue light will be reflected by this mirror. So this green part will just pass through this mirror and go to the detector. So you can see what is in the cortex. Okay, so now you can see some problems because if the brain is very thick, right? Now when you're activating your sample, you're activating a very thick, the whole brain, the cortex is about 1 millimeter thick, and you can only activate the superficial layers, right? So you can image very deep with these techniques. And also, the resolution is limited by this camera. And the most important is you don't have a very good resolution. So I'll just show you some data from this type of technique. So these are actually on V1, you have the orientation tuning. So each color here means the neuron is tuned to one of these orientations. And if you look at the whole structure of V1, the orientation tuning is actually organized in a very pretty way, which has the pinwheel shape. So each color means the tuning for one direction. Then if you zoom in into this map, you can see this with this center, and if you rotate, then this neuron around this center has a different tuning. Okay, so these are pretty, now if you look at this part, it's also the tuning of orientation, but with different depth inside this cortex. So this may be superficial layer, and this is the deepest layer. And you can see that the neuron, no matter which layer it is, it always has the same orientation tuning. So like each column of the cortex has the same tuning property. Now, if you use this type of technique, you're activating a whole column, and you're also collecting data from the whole column, and the whole column has the same response, then you can measure this type of vague map of tuning. But you don't see cellular structures. So these images are from something else. Okay, now what if you want to see neurons? You have to do something else, right? So these are some pictures from what is the real microscope people use to see neurons in the brain. So it looks much more complicated than this one. And I'll maybe briefly go through how does those work. So the first one I want to introduce is called confocal microscope. And maybe some of you know this guy, Marvin Minsky. So he is the father of artificial intelligence and also the founder of MIT Media Lab. And he is also the creator of this confocal microscope. And this is a diagram he has drawn on the patent. So the idea is to, you don't illuminate the whole sample at the same time. You just illuminate one point at one time, then move this point across the whole sample. So you have some scanning mirrors which are changing this laser coming into this mirror. Then you can change this parallel beam to different directions, right? Then remember different directions on this back resulting in a different position to this image plane. Then after this divergence, so it's still a different direction of beam than a different position on this brain. Right? So you can just change the direction of the beam, then choose which point you want to scan on this on your sample. Okay, so that's called laser scanning microscope. Now, the first step, you have to have a scanning machine and scan one point at one time. So what happens if you scan one point? Like all the fluorescence molecules inside this cone would be activated. Now you can collect your data in this way. So this another way to draw this laser coming from this way. Then this is the mirror which are changing this beam directions, and different direction resulting in a different position on your sample. Then what happens after your sample gave out the fluorescence? So the light also follow the same route and come back from this objective and follow the same thing and reflected by this mirror. And now at this point, it's reflected to this detector, right? So you can just repeat this process. Activate one point, then collect the data from that point, then activate another point, collect data from the other point. So you can just go through all the image by scanning, by the laser scanning. Okay, so now if you consider what is this detector getting, so this detector doesn't get any spatial information, right? Because no matter which point you are scanning on your sample plane, it always results in the same position on this detector. So what you only need to do is, what you only need to know is what is the signal amplitude from that point. And you know what is that, where is that signal from, because you are controlling this mirror, and you know where does that signal corresponding to. So you only need to know for each point what is the amplitude, and you can assign those amplitude to the specific pixel on your image. Right. So you don't need a camera here. Then what you need is called PMT, which is photon multiplier tube. So this thing collects the photon, then generate through this multiplication, then generate a current at the end. So this thing just convert the how many photons to how much current. So now you have this detector here, but what else you need to do is, in this case, add a pinhole. So this pinhole is the reason why it's called confocal microscope. So why is that? If you think about what did you excite at your sample, it's a cone shape. So everything inside that cone is all activated, right? But actually what you really want is the signal from that point, but not everything above that point. So you want to filter out those light from the other parts of the cone. So this is what this pinhole is doing. So if you take a closer look, this solid line is coming from the focal point, and this point emits the light and collected by the objective, then pass through this pinhole and reach your detector. But this dashed line is the something emitting light a little bit above your focal point. Then if you follow back this dashed line, you can see that it will be rejected by this pinhole. So adding this single components will let you do called optical sectioning. So you're only collecting data from somewhere deeper in your brain tissue. Okay. So if you compare, this is a confocal image and this is a wide field image from a camera, then you can see much higher resolution for a confocal microscope. Okay, question? Yeah?
How deep can you go into a specific?
In this confocal?
Yeah.
I'm not quite sure. Maybe 200-300 microns? Yeah. Maybe half of the cortex. But so next, I'm gonna introduce the two-photon microscope. So with this, you can even go deeper. So these are the four big names for two-photon microscope, and they won the Brin Prize in 2015. And this first two-photon laser scanning microscope paper was published in 1990 by some of those. So the principle of two-photon is, remember I introduced that this fluorescence protein can absorb some wavelength of photon, then jump to here, then relax, go back, right? And the other way to jump is to absorb two photon with half of the energy as this one. So if you absorb two photons at the same time, but each one has a half energy, which is a longer wavelength, in this case it's red light, then this molecule can also jump to this excited state. Then after that, it can relax, then give you this emission, fluorescence emission. So now in this case, what happens if you are using this red light to activate your sample? So this is the conventional confocal or fluorescence from single photon process, which is this from blue to green process. And this is the fluorescence from two-photon process. So you are only at the focal point, you can have two photons arrive at the same time. So only this single point is activated to this excitation state. Then only this point gives you fluorescence. So there's nothing happen within this cone above and below. So now if you look at this fluorescence, so this is one photon process. You can see this hourglass shape, but this is two photons. You can only see a single dot inside this fluorescent. Okay, so that's the principle of how two photons work. Before I go on, I want to show you a picture. Does anyone? Yeah, it's Matthew Center. And do you know who is she? All right, she is Maria G.M. And she's a physicist, which won the Nobel Prize, the second female Nobel Prize laureate after Marie Curie. And her contribution is to discover this two-photon process. So, and her PhD thesis is based on this, describing this two-photon absorption process. So this diagram showing you, so y-axis is the called cross-section, two-photon cross-section, which means the probability of you get activated, probability of absorbing two photons at the same time. And the unit is GM, which is her last name. Okay, so now let's compare what is the difference between this confocal and two-photon. So it's basically it looks similar. You all have the laser coming from here, then change the direction of the beam, then scan through your whole sample image. And the difference is you don't need this pinhole here, because only this single point is activated. You don't need to reject everything else, right? And okay, so no pinhole for two photon. And the other difference is the detector is closer to this sample plane. So consider what do you need to detect from two photon is you want to collect everything you can get from that point, right? Because you know everything you get is from that point. So you need to collect as much energy as possible. So you want to move your detector closer to this where the fluorescence is emitted. So to collect a lot of energy. Okay, and the third is the most tricky part. You need a different laser for this beam because you need the two photons arrive at the same time. But okay, so this diagram shows you this is a normal laser. So like this laser pointer, and each photon travels at the different time, and although they are all traveling at the same direction. But for two photon, you need like this ultra-short pulse laser. So each photon is like traveling together. So if you look at the waveform of the laser, it's a short pulse, then a long period of empty, then another short pulse. So this pulse is about 18 megahertz in that scale. So in this now, if you have some laser like this, the probability of you get two photon excitation at the focal point is relatively high. Then you can see the fluorescence. Okay, so basically you're concentrating the photons in space and time. Okay, so if you compare, all right. Oh, it's already 220. Okay, let me jump just to play some of the experiments that use this type of technology. So this, I actually posted this video on Facebook. And this is a two-photon recording from a macaque monkey. So you can see this like circular structure. Those each circle is one cell body. Can you guess why is it circular? Like why it's dark in the middle? What is a dark thing? nucleus. So the fluorescence protein doesn't go into the nucleus, it only stays outside. Then if you see something circular, that means the cell is healthy. Okay, so this is a population recording also from this macaque monkey, and it's from V1. So it's presenting a different orientation of these gratings, then you can see different populations of neuron light up. Okay, so this image are actually not very good quality, because for monkeys it's extremely difficult to record good quality, because primates the brain is much more scattering than mice, and in terms of surgery and risk and virus injection, it's so much different from mice. So, but this is the best quality image we can get right now. It's only published several weeks ago on Neuron. Okay, then there are just some more image and videos that you can get from a microscope. Okay, guess I'll just maybe stop here, and if you want to hear more about some other stuff, you can just maybe email me and I'll upload my slides. Okay, cool, thank you. Mm-hmm.